Hello. In this question, we're going to explore the concept of linear dependence. Here we are given a set S of three vectors, and we're asked to show they are linearly dependent. Now, in your textbook, you have a definition of linear independence. It says that you take some linear combination of the vectors equal to zero, and they are linearly dependent when the only solution is the solution where lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3 is equal to 0. I'm going to slightly rephrase this. Let's say that they're linearly independent when this equation has a unique solution, and they're going to be linearly dependent when there's more than one solution. Of course, if you were to meet this equation in the street and someone demanded of you that you solve it, you could solve it easily. You could just say, let lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 all be zero. Solution. There we are. The interesting part is that the only solution? If it is the only solution, the vectors are independent. If there are more solutions than just the zero solution, then they're dependent. Okay, so now we're in a kind of mindset where we can start using augmented matrices and solving things and looking at solutions and determining if things are dependent or independent. Great, so here's some vectors, here's an equation, we can solve that with an augmented matrix. So we're going to solve the system 1, negative 3, 2, 3, 2, 1, 4, negative 1, negative 1. And we're interested in how many solutions this has. And of course, you can just row reduce this, and I'll save you the trouble and just row reduce it for you. I'll remind you how to read off the number of solutions of a matrix which is in row echelon form. First of all, we should establish that it is, in fact, row echelon form. Here's the leading terms. I just move across each row and circle the first non-zero term I encounter. So this one doesn't have any leading terms in it down here. I notice that these form a nice descending staircase, if you like. That is to say, each term is above and to the right of the term below it. And once I have row echelon, and a row of zeros is on the bottom if you've got them. And once you have row echelon form, you can read off the number of solutions. The constant term here, or the augmented vector, is not leading. That tells me there are solutions. I already knew that just by looking at this equation. I knew there was going to be solutions. The presence of the non-leading column here, a column with no leading term in it, tells you that there are infinitely many solutions. In fact, it tells you can use lambda 3 as a parameter and thereby parameterize the infinite space of solutions to this equation. But at this point, we just need to know there's lots of solutions. Great, so there is more than one solution to this equation. In fact, there are infinitely many solutions. Therefore, the set is dependent. Now that we know the set is linearly dependent, we can write one of the vectors as a linear combination of the others. And this exactly characterizes the notion of linear dependence. You can always write one of the vectors as a linear combination of the others. Good, let's see how we can do that. Remember, in the previous part of this question, we were solving the equation. This is where we were at in the previous question. We only needed to determine how many solutions there were to this matrix to know that this was a linearly dependent set. But in order to actually write one of the vectors as a linear combination of the others, we need to go all the way and actually solve this system of linear equations. And the best way to do that? Reduced row echelon form. So I've omitted the row operations here, but I'm just going to go, I'll assume you know how to get from row echelon form to reduced row echelon form. The lovely thing about reduced row echelon form is you can easily unpack the solutions. This non-leading column here tells me how to choose my parameter. This is what gives me the infinitely many solutions. I can essentially choose the variable corresponding to this column, which is lambda 3, in any way I like. To indicate that, I'm going to promote lambda 3 and just call it lambda. It's the lambda, the parameter. From this row in my reduced row echelon form, I know lambda 2 plus lambda 3 equals 0. So lambda 2 is just negative lambda 3. And from this row, I know that lambda 1 plus lambda 3 is equal to 0. And so I could actually just omit the 3 here because I've promoted lambda 3 to be the lambda. And I know how to express this equation now as a system with just one variable in it. Lambda 1 is just negative lambda. Lambda 2 is just negative lambda, so I'll write that as negative lambda. Lambda 3 is just lambda, and it's equal to 0. Behold, my system of equations expressed with the single parameter lambda. Now I need just a little bit more space. And now I can rearrange this to express one vector as a linear combination of the others. This will hold for all lambdas, but in particular, when lambda equals 1, then this is equal to, well, I might do two things here. I might set lambda to equal to 1, and I'll take those two over to the other side. I can rewrite this as 4, negative 1, negative 1. Behold, one of the vectors written as a linear combination of the others. Now, if you've been pulling your hair out for the last 5 minutes and saying, no, don't do all that row reduction, clearly that plus that equals that, great, I'm glad you could see that. But most of the time, you're not going to be able to see what the linear combination is. If you can, certainly, you could just answer the question in this cheap way where you say, oh, that is that plus that, done. One of the vectors is a linear combination of the others, and you didn't have to go through the whole process of reduced row echelon form to get there. Sure. If you know what the linear combination is, fine, I won't get in your way. But most of the time, for us normal people, we need to go through the whole process of row echelon form, then reduced row echelon form, and extracting solutions to see what the linear combination is. Now we're asked to find a linearly independent subset of S. Fortunately, the working out for this question is something we've already done. So I've just left up the stuff from part C. And we're just going to stare at it and think for a little bit. Remember the intuition we built up in part C. The vectors are linearly dependent when you take an element of the span, and you can express an element of the span in many ways, in many different ways. On the other hand, they're linearly independent when you can express an element of the span in one way, in one unique way. So what we're going to do here is look at our augmented matrix and just chop off the non-leading columns. You see, these are what give us the infinitely many solutions. So if we just take our augmented matrix here and reduce it to row echelon form, or reduce row echelon form, you need a row echelon form. If I just chop off that column, then I get unique solutions. And notice it won't really matter what I put here, I'm always going to get unique solutions. This column was always going to be non-leading regardless of whatever stuff I put here. Okay, that tells me that this vector here, this one, I don't need it. I don't need it. And in fact, it's just redundant. Fantastic. Now, if I express, now my expression for 895 is unique. And hence, this is my linearly independent set of vectors. And the process is the same for your set of vectors, or any set of vectors you encounter. Just chop off the ones corresponding to non-leading columns. let's just think about what happened here. I have started with three vectors. I chopped off the linearly dependent ones, and I didn't change the span. This has exactly the same span as the set of vectors S, but it's better, it's more concise. Not only can I express any vector in the span as a linear combination of these two vectors, I can express it uniquely as a linear combination of these two vectors. So this is somehow a better the span of these two vectors is a better representation of the same set S. It's got less redundancy in it.